Hello everyone, welcome to another edition of GameCamp webinars. Today we will be talking about creatives, like I think very interesting and important topic nowadays. So we'll be talking about what can be different approaches for creative testing, creative ideas. So let's invite to the stage our amazing speakers. So let's invite Marijana in college, who works with ASO and UA at Peaksel.
Thanks, hello. Mark. Hi, everyone. Nice to be here today with you.
Thank you. Let's invite Snezana Djuric. She's CMO at Peaksel as well. Hello. And then let's invite Lucia, Mrvova, head of UA at AppAgent.
Hello. Hello.
And then let's invite Yulia Sharikova, who is gaming growth manager at Google, and she works with gaming companies. Hello, Yulia.
Hi, everybody. Hey. Hope everyone is well.
Okay, so let's go to the content. Of course, to everyone, if you would like to have the info about all the future webinars, you can just sign up for GameCamp newsletter, and then like every few weeks you will get the information about all different webinars happening in the next weeks. So you see the address. And of course, please join us on Slido as well, because that's good, amazing opportunity to ask questions, vote on other questions, and ask our amazing speakers the questions around their presentations and around other topics related to that creative idea. So just go to the Slido and then put GameCamp as the name of the event, and then you can join the discussion. So not spending much time on that, let's go with the first presentation. Snezana and Marijana, the stage is yours.
Thanks. All right. So hi once again, everyone. It is lovely to be here. What we're going to talk about today, as Marius said, is creatives, different approaches, different ways, what we like, what we don't like, what we've tried. We're going to tell you a little bit about how we do it here at Peaksel. Before we start, let me just briefly introduce myself. So my name is Snezana. I'm a CEO here at CMO here at Peaksel. And I've been with the company for about 7 years now. I've done different roles that led me to be where I am right now. I lead a team about 14 people who cover different areas of marketing like ASO, UA, customer support, monetization, data analytics, and QA on the marketing side. Today here with me is also Marijana, and I'll let her introduce herself.
Thanks, Snezana. My name is Marijana. I've been with the Peaksel company almost 5 years. And since last year, I'm leading the user acquisition team as a part of the bigger publishing team. During my talk today, I'll provide you with a background on our creative process, both on Google Ads and Facebook platform.
All right. Before we get to the agenda, let me just briefly tell you a little bit about Peaksel. So we are a mobile apps and games developer and publisher from Niš, southern Serbia. We've been in business for about 9 years, and we've published around 300 apps and games so far. We have 60 full-time employees, and we work with around 30 freelancers. A lot of them are translators that we work with, because we translate our apps and games into usually 25 or more languages. We've done, as you can see from our portfolio, we've done a lot of apps and games in different genres. Right now, our main focus is on logic puzzle games. As for our agenda, we'll be talking a little bit about our creative process. We'll talk about new concepts and iterations, how we come up with new concepts, what we do at iterations, how much we iterate, etc. And then we'll also mention a little bit about the link between store listing, in particular Google Play store listing, and UA assets. And then finally, we'll share some tips and tricks of what we've learned along the way. I'll let Marijana take over, as she'll be telling you a little bit about our creative process.
Thanks again. So as I mentioned, we will be talking about our creative process on Facebook and Google Ads. So let's start first with Facebook. When we are testing creatives on Facebook, we are following some rules, which I listed here on this slide. And it is very important to follow them, so get the best results for your campaigns. So let's start with the first rule, which is statistical significance, which basically means that you need to accumulate satisfactory volumes and to reach about 300 installs per every ad tested in order to get over 90% of statistical significance. The second rule is to try to reduce bias as much as possible. That's the tricky one, but it's doable. So you can do that in two ways. You can force equal delivery by pulling ads into the separate ad sets. So you will have only one ad per one ad set, and make sure that the settings for each ad set is completely the same. And the second thing you can do to reduce bias is to have a separate account that you will use only for testing, or to make sure to use a completely brand new campaign. So you will not use a control one where there are already top creatives that are actively scaling your account. And finally, the third rule that we are following when we are testing creatives on Facebook is to evaluate accordingly. So try to adapt your KPIs you are evaluating by and the benchmarks by the platform and the format that you are testing. So the primary KPIs would be IPM, CPI, ROI, CTR, etc. And the secondary ones would be relevance score and engagement. So once you follow all these important rules, you can start testing. As you can see on this slide, I gave you one example of our one of our A/B tests. Before I move to results of this A/B test, I want to say that given that today automation is taking over more and more of what used to be UA manager job, one of the biggest lever we can pull today is creative. So here is an example for one of our A/B tests for our app for Asian market. Given that we tested four completely different concepts and ideas, our main KPIs for this test were CPI along with the IPM. And as you can see, the results are below every creative. The best CPI has the first banner, and it is $0.94, along with the IPM, which is a 9. So we got 9 installs per 1,000 impressions. Comparing to 3 other concepts where CPI was a lot higher and the IPM was almost twice lower. So the winner is the first one. And once you prove the concept and you prove the winner, then you can start thinking about the iterations. Thank you. As I said, when you prove the concept, you can start thinking about the iterations. Try maybe 3 to 4 significant iterations in order to avoid missing out on a potential winner, because sometimes, or quite often, I would say, a difference between a winner and a loser is very small. Here is the example of what would be the next steps for our winning concept. This is the test that we still need to run, so I don't have the results. We started with different colors for the first iterations. My advice is to think big when you start iterating. So try different colors or color versus black and white. Try different characters, real versus animated, whatever idea you came up with. So for the Facebook testing, try to follow those rules as much as you can, and start iterating once you prove the concept. Okay, now we can move to the next slide. Thank you. Now we will be talking about our creative process on Google Ads platform. Before I started, I want to tell you that when you start producing banner ads, try to be compelling. Try to make banners that are eye-catching in order to attract attention. Try to be clear, so to make sure your message sticks. And finally, try to be clear in a way that don't try to say too much, because at the end, the ad may end up looking cluttered. So clearly communicate a single marketing message for a single product. So now we can move on Google Ads. Google Ads is quite different comparing to Facebook platform, because we cannot run A/B test there. But what we can do, and we can have different ad groups. And by having different ad groups with different copies, banners, and videos, you will reach to different users, and you will try to convey different message also. So when we start running UAC campaigns, we first started with the one ad group that contains images with girls. And then we came up with more ideas. So we made the second ad group, now with banners with men. And finally, the third one that contains some kind of banners with devices. So in that way, we had three completely different ad groups into the same campaigns with completely different copies, banners, and videos. So there is a tricky part here also, or funny maybe. What we saw here is that copies will always convert, no matter in which ad group they are. But banners and videos in second and third group were staying in a learning phase. So we couldn't have the results. We couldn't see how they will convert, because we had a really small number of impressions for those types of creatives. Comparing to the first ad group, so the banners with girls, those types of creatives in that ad group were actively converting and scaling. So although it's not advisable to mix different concepts and ideas, we didn't have nothing to lose, because we wanted to see the results for newly produced banners. And we decided to switch them off and transfer them into the first ad groups, where we had a lot of impressions for those types of creatives, for images and videos. And after a few days, they finished the learning phase, and we were able to compare them into the same ad groups and finally get the results. So to conclude here on Google Ads, although you cannot A/B test here, try to take advantage of having different ad groups with different text, different banners, different videos, and try to reach to different users to convey your message to them. And now Snezana will take over and talk to you a little bit about iterations.
Right. So as Manya mentioned, and she mentioned a little bit about iterations and new concepts anyway, but as you can see, we do them. And it's important to think about new concepts and iterations as well. When we test concepts and iterations, we try to apply the 80-20 rule. So of all the creatives that we create, usually 20% of them are new concepts, or as new as they can be. And then 80% are iterations. So we try to twitch it here and there. And as Manya already said, sometimes the smallest difference can actually make the difference between a winner and a loser. So, you know, we try, we get different ideas, and then we test. And as Marijana has mentioned, not all platforms are suitable for testing. They each have their own system and way to go. For now, our favorite one is TikTok, although you've seen that we use Google Ads and Facebook as well. The reason we use TikTok is the fact that creatives just go like crazy there. So the ad fatigue is just amazing. So you'd have to add new creatives all the time on, I would say, daily basis if possible. And this gives us a lot of opportunity to test and experiment. I'm going to show you a couple of examples of the creatives that we've done for TikTok, where one of the examples is about iterations and the other one is about new concept being better. So here are three videos. This first one will show that the new concept actually did really well. Here's the video for a ringtone app that was showing at a time. It's really hard not to move around and dance because the music is so catchy. So that was the current version. And then we thought, okay, what is it that we can do that's different? So we tried sort of a gameplay walkthrough for this app. And here's the video that we came up with. And as you can tell, this one was a hit. It brought 350% more revenue than the current version that was showing at the time. That was the previous video. So we figured, hey, this is great. Let's keep iterating and see what we can come up with. And then we did an iteration. This one was okay, but not as good as the original concept. But it showed us that we should keep thinking of new ways to test our creatives. The second one is also about a ringtone app. Here you will see that we did a different new concept, which was this sort of geometric, abstract way of showing the app. What we've noticed is the video did well. It didn't, you know, go through the roof, but it did well enough for us to think about the iterations and how we can improve it. So I'm going to play the original video and then I'll play the iterations. So this was the original, like I said, well enough to keep us going. This was the first iteration that we did. This one was kind of my favorite because of the music, but it did okay. And then we came up with this iteration. And this one was actually a hit. It brought 300% more revenue than the second best video showing at the time. And perhaps you can look at it as sort of a new concept, but for us, it was just in this sort of geometric abstract style. So we called it an iteration. But anyway, it did great. And so these two examples go to show that sometimes the new concept's gonna be great, but sometimes it won't, but it'll still give you enough to keep iterating. Hi, Julia.
Hey, yeah, I actually have a question here. That's really interesting that you presented the videos itself and actually tackled the topic, the concepts and iterations. So my question would be, how would you recommend balancing between these two approaches, new concept or iteration, and especially for the small studios who do not have really much resources to invest into it?
Mm-hmm. Right. So actually this, our process of iterating in concepts was an idea of one of our designers for specifically for TikTok. because we've been just doing a bunch of videos. And he said, you know what, hey, why don't we think about this? How about we do a couple of weeks of iterations and then we do a new concept and then we iterate and do a new concept, because we've realized that for TikTok, at least, we can iterate more often and it kind of goes well enough to keep us going. So you don't have to think about new concepts all the time. So that's sort of our story. But if you can, and if possible, you should come up with new concepts on a like weekly basis, if this is something that's possible for you, depending on the size of the studio, on your finances and budget as well. Sometimes I think you just need to give it a try for a couple of weeks, because as you're iterating, you learn new things. So sometimes having new concepts like once a month would be a good idea. For smaller studios, honestly, I mean, you can see that these videos are, they're very nice and I love my designers for doing them, but they're not too complex. So for a lot of platforms, simple things go. And you don't have to, you know, have this huge video production that's gonna take days to do. Both of our designers learned a lot of different video tools and video making tools. And then we've been just experimenting. There are also certain tools that you can subscribe, like monthly subscription would be fairly cheap, and that help you make videos. So if you don't have a video designer, or if you just don't know how to do it, you can try it on your own. And if you're a really small studio, I think this will also go, because it gives you a chance to try. You don't have to be too skilled. You just sort of need to know what goes and what doesn't go when it comes to perhaps colors or different shapes. But there's definitely a way to go with this cheap until you find something that works. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Very interesting take. Thanks.
Yeah, no problem. All right. Another thing that we wanted to talk about today is the connection between store listing and UA creatives. More specifically, as I said, Google Play store listing. We have a ton of apps and games and we test a lot. So there's always an experiment running on Google Play. So we always test something. We've heard around, of course, but you know, it just takes time for you to hear something and then actually think it's a good idea to try it out. At one point, we just sat down and we thought, okay, can we connect our two teams, the ASO and UA team, and just exchange ideas just to see what's going on across our platforms, both organic and paid? And we actually saw that we could use these ideas that have been used in different teams. And we decided to try and apply conclusions from the UA to the ASO and vice versa and see how that goes. Sometimes we get greater results, sometimes not so much, but we tend to try it and see how it turns out. The first example I'm gonna give you is for one of our games. So this is a virtual pet game. What we decided to test was the game icon. And after a lot of tests, the result was this very bright pinkish color, and we thought, okay, so if you know pink is the way to go, let's give it a try. Based on this app icon or game icon, we decided to create a new video that we would be using as our UA creative. At the time, a video that was running as a creative was this one. As you can see, the click-through rate was 6.28% and the conversion rate was 25%. Okay, not great, but not too bad. Now, as I told you, we figured, you know, pink is the way to go. So we created a new video that was even more pinkish, if that's possible. And here's what it looked like. As you can see, the click-through rate was actually exactly the same as the previous one, but the conversion rate was 86%. So it was a great success for us, and we thought it was a job well done. So sometimes, you know, things are going to work and you have to give it a try. Sometimes you just have to be, you know, bold enough. Sometimes you just have to say, okay, well, we won't do this now. There's not enough time, or we don't have enough budget for it. But every time you can try and recycle as well. Recycling is a great idea. Sometimes you just need to change things just a tiny bit to make them different, and it works. And then to end this presentation, I'd like to share some tips that we've learned over time. The first one is to establish and encourage communication between ASO and UA teams. This is really, really important because those two teams are working on the same thing pretty much, just from different perspectives. One is paid, one is organic. But sometimes you can even reuse creatives. You can, as you've seen, use the ideas for from one team to another. It's just a great way to communicate and to focus on the product that you're working on. Another thing I'd like to say is to train your designers, not to do the work they're supposed to do, but to understand why they're doing things the way they are. Not only, you know, okay, they know they're making creatives for campaigns, but also give them a bigger picture, make them understand what this campaign does, how users react to it. You know, we taught our designers to read campaigns enough to know what the audience is saying. And that actually gave us great results because our designers were so proactive about giving ideas, and they would come up with this great concepts, or, you know, they would come up at the office and say, well, now online, I guess, not at the office, but they'd see something that's totally out of the gaming industry, and they would think it's a good idea to give it a try. In that sense, you should treat each platform as its own entity when testing and when giving things a try. I know it can be very hard, especially if you're a small studio, if your budget is very limited. And if you can't, that's fine. But whenever you can, try to treat it as a separate thing, because as you've seen, they're very different, and sometimes things just won't go. But sometimes one creative can go great across platforms. So definitely, definitely recycle. But when you can, try different approaches. It's good to have occasional brainstorming time. I'd say perhaps once a month, because you still want to give your team time to come up with new ideas, to think of something else. Like I said, our designers, you know, they would look out outside the industry. We've used ideas from Nike or just random Instagram pages where we've seen ads, because we thought we could adjust it to our product. And then finally, like the last but probably the most important one, is to keep testing. I know this can be budget that you see as wasted because you don't get the return on it, literally, but you do get a lot of knowledge and you get a lot of experience for your entire team. And this, I know it's not financially the same, but sometimes it can be even more valuable. So keep testing. And with that, I'd like to conclude this presentation. Thank you so much. If there are any questions, feel free to ask, or just, you know, stick around for the Q&A at the end of the second presentation. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Snezana and Marijana, for very, very interesting presentation. Thank you. Thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
Of course, to everyone, please add the questions at Slido. And maybe before we go to next presentation, I will ask you the question that actually is even interesting for me. You are testing a lot of like games and apps. Do you see any differences between testing games of apps, or you see it as kind of, you know, the same process? And there is way more differences between, like, you know, channels rather than, like, you know, the type of the app. How do you see it?
Maybe I can start, and then Marijana, you can jump in if you'd like to add. I think there is and there is no difference in a way. I think for apps, the process can be simpler, especially in our case. Most of our apps are sort of simple to navigate, so it's easier to make creatives compared to games. So in that way, the process may be faster. One of the things that I've heard, and then I noticed it with our apps as well, is that sometimes creatives for apps last a lot longer on a platform mm-hmm. compared to those for games. So that would be sort of my two cents. Mm-hmm. And then Marijana, you want to jump in with something else?
Yes, I will. I want to add that sometimes we saw that doing user acquisition for game is more expensive comparing to apps. And when we produce creatives for games, I think that we are more open-minded and have a lot more ideas than with apps. But it's more expensive.
Yeah, definitely. You can play with the game a lot more than with the app, mm-hmm. and both in terms of visual creatives, but also in terms of text. So the copy mm-hmm. Can also be, you know, a lot more variety with copy compared to mm-hmm. the app.
Thank you.
I also got a little question. So I came from the background where I worked with the games when I was one of those people who brainstormed and came up with the ideas for new creatives. So at this point, what do you think about seasonal creatives? So for example, for Christmas or for Halloween, if you have like resources and time, would you recommend investing in those or better to just invest in whatever works already for you, where you know how to create, where you know what topics to show and what works for your campaigns?
Mm-hmm. Manya, do you want to take this one over, or I can do it?
So we will definitely use seasonal creative testing for Christmas, or maybe, for example, now it will be a golden week for in Japan. So we are also preparing creatives that we will run only in this period for that holiday.
If I may add, though, okay, Golden Week is just very Japan specific. So you definitely, if you're localizing, give it a try. One thing that we noticed, for example, for Christmas, because it is worldwide holiday, of course. But 1 year we tried doing a whole bunch of our countries that celebrate Christmas on December 25th. But we didn't get such great results. The next year, we didn't want to pass it. So what we did is we just took English-speaking countries. And that actually worked really well for us. So sometimes it also depends on the type of the game or the app. You may not have to, or you may not want to do every single country. You can choose the one that's potentially the most prominent one. Or like for Christmas, I think the US is kind of most commercial, kind of holiday-ish slash... Mm-hmm. Buy everything holiday. So I think it worked well. I mean, I'm sorry for saying this. I've got great friends from the US, but it's just the way it is. And then Australia and UK kind of follow. So what we thought would be a good idea to just, you know, give it a try and see if that works. And it worked for us.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
So please stay with us. Because we'll have this Q&A session at the end. And for now, let's invite our second speaker, Lucia Mrvova, who is head of UA at AppAgent. And she'll be talking about testing and scaling game and app.
Yes, yeah. Thanks a lot for the introduction. Super happy to be here, really excited for the session. So as you know, my name is Lucia and I'm the head of user acquisition here at AppAgent, which is an award-winning mobile marketing agency based out of Prague. We are a team of just over 20 people, but actually work with quite some prominent clients from both the app and the gaming space. Recently, we've done some cool top performing creatives for Supercell. So that's been really, really exciting for the whole of the team. And today, exactly, I'll be talking to you about creative testing in launching and scaling both mobile apps from both perspectives. So whether it's actually apps or games. So without further ado, the agenda of my session today will be, we'll quickly touch upon why the creative testing itself is so important, where to test, how to test, with kind of 6 golden rules, some most common mistakes that I've seen also very large advertising accounts do, a few tips from my personal experiences on how to best collaborate between the user acquisition and creative teams, and then we'll just wrap up with the key insights from the whole session. So why is the creative testing important? And this was already touched upon in the first session. It really is one of the two major marketing levers that the user acquisition managers have at hand. I would argue that one is, of course, the optimization events. So what kind of in-app conversion event do you optimize your campaigns towards? This can really move the needle and improve or, of course, worsen your performance. And then the other one is creatives and the communication. How do you communicate your product to your target audience, which is more and more important, actually, not only due to all the automation taking place on all the major marketing platforms, but also with the upcoming IDFA deprecation on the latest iOS system. This will become even more important as you will have less and less actual, let's say, targeting levers to pull as a UA manager. So, but apart from knowing that creative testing is important, then you should definitely, you need to feed the machine with lots of creatives. It's also important to have some methodology in place, so solid methodology, that you have some sort of system in place for how you execute, how much and how often. And as you will see on the couple of examples that follow this slide, this can actually really have a huge impact on your performance and overall also business economics. So here the first example is from actually gaming space. This was a gaming client. As you can see, it's anonymized, but basically interesting to note here is that the concept itself, the unique selling proposition, the copy, even the targeting and the overall campaign setup were all completely identical. And this client of ours was looking to find out what famous character they could potentially partner up with in order to, of course, again, boost their growth and just gain more users. And so the only variable that was changing across all of these ads was the characters represented by the puppies. And what you can note here, so we only see the top and the mid funnel, right? So we are looking here at the click-through rate and the conversion rate. And you see by only changing the character, so like one single variable out of all the others, the performance actually varies greatly. And something I like to refer to as the performance UA paradox is that whilst the performance, the creative on the very left has the best click-through rate, it has average, almost below average conversion rate. Meanwhile, the one on the very right, which has the worst click-through rate out of the whole set of four, has actually the best conversion rate, and it's really, it's almost double of the second best, right? So this is really kind of big change. And this is also why it's very important to always not only test things, but also look at the full funnel performance and not only kind of select either the top or the bottom, but really consider how are the users behaving throughout the whole journey when reacting to your ads. Now, the second example is from the fitness space. This is an app called Fitify that we've worked with. And again, as you can see, this is also basically just four variances or iterations of the very same concept. One interesting thing I would also bring out here is that out of the four, only one is the video. So this goes slightly against the common, I guess, belief that the video is the only way to go. Again, it really does depend, and you should definitely test both formats, because as you can also see from this particular example, statics can work and sometimes really do outperform the videos, which again depends on not only what type of app you are, but also, of course, what type of audience you're targeting and on what platform too. And so here you can see, so we've added the bottom funnel performance, so we can also see what the return on investment was in this particular case. And again, we can see the so-called paradox that I referred to in the first example, where even though the winner on the very left has the worst click-through rate, actually the conversion rate is quite decent and the return on investment is by far the best out of the four. So again, do make sure to test and always look at the full funnel performance. Don't let yourself get deceived by one metric or the other. To quickly touch upon where to test. So naturally, of course, you will want to test where the majority of your user acquisition runs. So for many apps, this will be Facebook, which is also quite, let's say, easy and comfy to use for creative testing. If you do creative testing on Facebook, I definitely highly recommend you to kind of set it up manually and not use their built-in features, because this will allow you to really make sure that you have equal delivery over the same period of time, and it, there is no bias, because as we all know, the algorithm on Facebook tends to decide quite quickly and start skewing the delivery towards one variant or the other. And that means you might actually end up having biased results from this. In the gaming space, particularly since for gaming, it's a lot more common to also run quite large proportion of user acquisition on ad networks. Here, programmatic platforms like, for example, Kaizen are becoming very popular. Also because the inventory is cheaper, but not only because of that, it also actually gives you some sort of control in terms of white and blacklisting the publishers, which is also an important element. So in the case that you would be testing, again, on Facebook, for example, I would highly recommend that you select a single placement, for example, feed, so that you can kind of measure both ads over a consistent environment. If you were to, you know, run them on automated placements, one might get more delivery on audience network, which is also an environment that you are not sure where exactly it goes and what it looks like. And all of these aspects, of course, then reflect back on your performance and might skew the results. So that would be, again, a form of bias that you would like to avoid. So moving on to how to test, I have kind of compiled six, so to say, golden rules. We will touch each of these in a bit more detail, but basically it's super important that you create an agile process for your team where you consistently develop new creatives and feed the performance machine with new concepts. And as was mentioned also in the earlier session, it's important that you pay attention to the statistical significance, as well as try and eliminate bias and, of course, evaluate accordingly. And then it's also important to kind of deliver a consistent user experience on the whole user acquisition journey. So let's look a little bit deeper on integrating the whole creative testing into an agile process. As you can see on the diagram, this process really is a loop that continues to repeat itself. Basically, from personal experience, I would highly recommend to appoint one main responsible person from the user acquisition team and one main person from the actual creative team, from the designers team. So these two people can really streamline and drive the activities and then take it back to their teams. And that way, basically, you can avoid yourself a lot of headaches a lot of the time. And this is definitely something that needs to run on a continuous basis. The machine, so to say, should never stop. You should always have fresh content in production. And absolutely, the user acquisition and creative teams must communicate, ideally, even on a daily basis. But it's ideal to basically for the two, let's say, leaders to meet on a weekly basis and prioritize things for both of the teams. So to address also the topic of concepts versus iterations, which was briefly touched upon previously as well, I would definitely recommend when you are trying new things, focus on the concept first and don't straight away dive into, you know, making 10 to 20 variations of it, as you would first like to prove if the concept itself works. But with that being said, it is actually important to do, I would say, two, maximum three, really, really major iterations, variations of that original new concept, because it is oftentimes, you know, once not even small, but it is one variable, one element, detail that actually makes or breaks the creative or the concept itself. And you definitely want to avoid losing out on a great new concept just because you did it in the wrong color or you used, you know, the wrong character. As we've seen before, also, you know, partial funnel metrics can also be very confusing. So this is why it's important to kind of try a few major iterations every time you are working on a new concept. In terms of cadence, I would say if you're spending anywhere between 100 to 500K a month across your user acquisition channels, I think five original concepts, which gives you up to 20 creatives exports, so to say, on a weekly basis, would be an ideal place to start. In terms of the iterations, the kind of main big iterations, what you can think of is, again, like animated versus black and white, or using different characters, like we've seen on my first example where we had different puppies. Or also the style, right? So it can be a real shooting, shot video or a picture as compared to, for example, an animation or illustration. To just show you how this iteration cycle can look like on a weekly basis, here is a diagram. So basically you would have five concepts. Let's assume that the concept number four actually outperforms all of the others, and we can say that this is a winner compared to our benchmarks, right? So what comes then is it's important to identify the key variables. What are the main elements that we assume are really the main drivers behind this concept's performance? And here what comes handy is an automation. So at AppAgent, we also have our own proprietary creative automation tool, which allows us to do exactly this. So once we've sat down and kind of analyzed all the key elements, we tag them, and thanks to our software, we can easily create up to 50, 60 variations just within a few hours. You know, this would normally take designers days or even weeks to kind of compile if they were to do it manually. So automation can really be of great help here. So on this slide, you can actually see an example of such automation that we've done for one of our clients, again, Empires and Puzzles. This is a game, of course, many of you probably know it. And as you can see, they really look very differently. So they look distinctively like different ads, but actually it is just iterations of the same concept. We've changed colors, we've moved the logos around slightly, and we've played around with the call to action buttons. And this already gave us, as you can see, 10 quite distinctly different ads with a different feel to them. Moving on to the statistical significance, it was already mentioned before that this is quite important, and you should definitely pay attention to it. Throughout our testings, we found that as long as you run on mobile app installs, reaching around roughly 300 installs will actually give you that over 90% confidence. That is the kind of sweet spot for you to, let's say, scientifically be able to determine, is this working or not? Is it better or worse compared to, you know, what we've been running before? Of course, as soon as you switch to event optimization or value optimization, these volumes will change and you will have to adapt them yourself. There are also some websites for free that actually can help you determine whether the result is statistically significant or not. So just make sure that you pay attention to it, but of course, also use your common sense. There is no need to wait for 300 installs if you haven't seen an install past, let's say, the first 10,000 impressions, generally. Reducing bias is a tricky one. There is probably no way to eliminate all the bias completely, but there are a few things you can do to reduce it as much as possible. This is, for one, forcing equal delivery by putting ads into separate ad sets, specifically if we are talking about Facebook, but also some other platforms will allow you to do that, such as, for example, TikTok. And this will really allow you. So this, again, is all about don't use the built-in feature, which may actually create some bias by not delivering equally to the two variants. Then having a separate account can actually be also super useful if you can afford to do that, because then you make sure that the data is not really polluted you know, from all the learnings from your past tests and also the top winners. If this is too much hassle for you, which oftentimes it can be, at least I highly recommend you that you test all the new creatives in a completely separate campaign to where you're actually scaling and using your, you know, winning creatives that you would basically use as a control to compare results with, because this again can pollute the data. The algorithm will definitely get skewed towards it and might not even bring enough delivery to your new creatives. And using two-layer testing is also something that will actually help to save you a lot of time and money. And what I mean by that is that, firstly, you should try and test the creatives on the optimized for app installs, which can, again, save you just a lot of budget and you will see results a lot quicker. And once you've seen the top funnel performance, you can kind of get, you know, the middle to top and retest it on event to value optimization, and that way really get your true winners. So what you can see on the example here on the table, these are campaigns that we ran for one of our clients, Wargaming. And this just shows you how vast really the difference can be. So imagine how big, this is just one channel with different optimizations. Of course, this applies to also running on different channels and different placements. And of course, the biggest impact we can see is on CPM, where running app install campaigns is a lot cheaper compared to event optimized campaigns, which then is also reflected in CPIs naturally. But you can also see that the difference on click-through rate is quite huge. It's very significant. And somewhat, there is a somewhat of a difference also in the conversion rate, and IPM is again quite significant here. So just make sure that you cover yourself from both of these ends.
And wait, sorry, Lucia, may I ask a question? I feel like I'm interrupting everybody, but it's very interesting, like regarding those 8 tests that you had, right? So did you run all of those in parallel, like in one go, or did you give a chance to like some of them run first and then edit 4 more?
Sorry, which 8 tests do you
have? Eight examples of the test you showed on the 2 slides before, I think. So yeah, there are like a few different tests. So did they run in parallel? The previous one, I think. Yeah.
Do you mean all these?
Yeah.
Yeah, so this in particular was not run in parallel, like all of these. This was run in batches. But normally, so for example, if we, so I will just jump quickly backwards. So for example, with these were running parallel, right? So this is basically 4x4. There was actually more variations in that. But those were running parallel, exactly split into individual ad groups and even campaigns in the first case. But here, so this is basically a snapshot of 10, but we actually created around 40 variations for this particular case, and they were run in batches.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Most welcome. Cool. So to continue with evaluating accordingly, again, here you can see a snapshot from Facebook, which I'm sure all of you recognize. And here you can see how different really the performance is just by different placements. I'm sure all of you know this, but basically just to illustrate that really across the whole funnel, whether it's CPM or CPC or the click-through rate, the difference is massive. And this is exactly why it's also important when you test new creatives to isolate the placement if you can, and you know, just to make sure that you are running it in somewhat consistent environment, which for example a feed would be, unlike again for example audience network, where you don't even really know where and how the ads are shown. So this allows you to really compare apples to apples essentially. And then of course pay attention to channels, right? Like if you are running a lot of YouTube creatives and using, you know, just majorly Google app campaigns, then of course you will also have some additional or different KPIs that you want to look at, such as view rate, for example, for videos, which you might necessarily consider when looking at Facebook performance. So again, just make sure that you are looking also at your benchmarks, at your own benchmarks, as they relate to that channel in question, where, for example, 1% click-through rate may be great on Facebook, but is actually not so impressive at all for Google. Connecting the dots, so this is also something the girls previously mentioned. It is really crucial to provide a consistent user experience throughout the whole user acquisition journey. And you can see an example of how to perfectly execute that on these images from Lily's Garden. This is one of the top grossing games still, I believe. And you can see how they easily recreate the whole kind of emotion from the very first impression on the ad, going through the app store, even all the way to the onboarding inside the app. And we have seen this, having done some testings around this with the gaming specifically ourselves, we've also seen that this actually does influence the performance all the way to the return on investment and even the retention itself. And it can really have a huge, huge impact. It's something that is oftentimes kind of forgotten or not really executed. So I would like to bring your attention back to it. And you can easily do this by, you know, if you find it too complicated to like focus on the same color palette or so, you can actually easily do this by reusing a particular element or character. As you can see, Lily's Garden, for example, does it brilliantly by using the house on all of the images. And then, of course, also the overall look and feel is maintained. But just kind of like a quick and easy way to start would be if you have a game, for example, you can choose a character which can be featured on all of these steps in the funnel. And this will definitely show you some nice improvements in terms of conversion rates and overall engagement even afterwards in the app itself. So with that, let's look at a few major mistakes that I've seen, again, really big advertisers' accounts do. So just to quickly sum them up, one of them would be not considering the full funnel performance, which is something we've touched upon on some of the previous slides, being impatient and interrupting tests prematurely, just because you kind of think you're getting there. And also creating limitations by your own team from your own kind of expectations sometimes. So I'll show you what I mean by that in a second. So firstly, make sure that you do consider the full funnel KPIs. As you saw also before, the performance varies quite greatly. Like sometimes, and more often than not, what performs the best on top of the funnel is not by far the best on bottom of the funnel. And there are some primary and secondary KPIs that you should always be looking at. So primarily, of course, you want to make sure that it's scalable, right? It's scalable, for which it needs to have a good click-through rate. Then, of course, you're interested in seeing the conversion rate or IPM. So whether you're looking at how many people installed from the amount of impressions or clicks. That's up to you. You can also use both metrics, which is something I do. And last but not least, of course, what we all want to know is this actually profitable? So what's the return on investment? The secondary KPIs that you really want to look at are also, for example, on platforms like Facebook, relevance score and engagement. Are people liking, commenting, engaging? Because this has a direct influence on the scalability of the ad in question. And something that some of you might not know is actually you must be careful also with rejections. So rejections are, so to say, remembered on your account and can also influence the scalability of your ads and of the account as such. So make sure that you pay attention to this and play by the rules. Allowing enough time to pass. I've seen this, I think, honestly, with all the apps, whether it's been gaming or fitness or education, there always is some sort of seasonality, weekly seasonality, whether it's more activity and better performance over weekends or vice versa. With, for example, financial apps, it would be during the week when people are more productive and interested in these things. So that's why it's always a good idea to run for full 7 days and get your results for the kind of whole weekly seasonality that you can observe. And at the same time, of course, you want to make sure that you exit the learning phase so that you know that the results you are looking at are actually optimized and relevant and will stay somewhat around those values. Now, again, going back to my previous point, of course, common sense, if you don't need to wait for 7 days if you have very strong indicators that the ad will just like not work at all. And the last one is regarding the limitations. So as I mentioned, teams oftentimes limit themselves, which sometimes comes from things like branding guidelines, some strict rules of how you want to look or don't want to look. And sadly, as many designers will know, the work of a marketing designer is oftentimes frustrating because sometimes it's really the not so beautiful and polished things that actually resonate with the audience much more and bring the best results. However, this is just how it is. And sometimes you really do need to step out of the box and not limit yourself by, just creating certain rigid expectations. And it's also important to remember that this is a numbers game and it's not about avoiding to lose, because you will lose and you will lose many times. It's, from my experience, one out of every maybe 30, 40 creatives that actually becomes the breadwinner. So the trick is to just lose fast and, collect all your learnings and just keep moving. And eventually you will find the winner that will just make up for all the losses you've accumulated on the ways, which also brought you lots of learnings so that you don't have to repeat them in the future. And last point on, so some of my tips on collaborating with UA teams or between UA teams and creative teams. Again, what I found most useful is to appoint one person on each side that coordinates the teams. Those two people at least should really meet on a weekly basis. It's important that the user acquisition team does take the time of their day to sit down and kind of translate the results into a plain human language for the designers. Because it's really crucial for the design team to actually understand this as they can then derive their own learnings and understanding and work on, for example, iterations or even creating new concepts once they understand what the performance looks like and what are the key factors and variables. As far as we are talking about the actual production process, I do recommend highly everyone to check in early on the production process, because sometimes it has happened in the past to me that, for example, you will pitch a concept to the design team and then they go execute. 1 week later, you get the whole done thing, but it's actually not what you expected. So this is why it's always a good idea to check in halfway through and just make any adjustments that you find suitable. And of course, retrospective is super crucial. Whether you would like to do this monthly or quarterly, that's totally up to you. But very highly recommended for both teams to sit together periodically and just look back on what they have done either in the past month or quarter and what learnings, again, they have accumulated and how they can take these things forward. Just to show you what this process kind of looks like, again, same as before, right? It's a continuous loop that basically just keeps running, and you should keep feeding the performance machine and the creative machine. You can also do this on a bi-weekly basis. I understand that, for example, for a small startup, it may be a bit too much to move on a weekly basis. Just make sure that you really do it regularly is basically the point, right? And then it's important that you have a hypothesis from which you create a concept. Essentially, I see this as collaboration between the UA and the design team. Then, of course, once the design team delivers the actual ads, it's up to the UA team to run the tests, collect the results, again, translate them for the design team. Then the two teams sit together again, derive conclusions and actionable insights. And based on this, the decision is made mutually, whether we iterate or move on into creating, basically focusing new concepts, and the loop continues. And so now we will just wrap up with the key insights. So first and foremost, always keep producing fresh content. Make sure that you don't get yourself stuck because you just found the winner and you think it's gonna, bring money for the next half a year. We all know that ads fatigue super duper fast, especially these days. A good cadence to start with, again, the reference here was if you're spending roughly 100 to 500,000 a month across your channels, five concepts a week, from which each would have two, maximum three major iterations. You should really try and test over the full 7 days to cover your weekly seasonality and make sure you exit learning phase. When possible, isolate the placement and reach the statistical significance. So again, isolating the placement just allows you to kind of control the environment a little bit and make sure that the results are consistent and you are comparing apples to apples. Be agile and make sure that your UA and creative teams are communicating and collaborating really closely. And there is also some sort of translation going on from the UA team to the designer team in terms of performance and what is working and not, and maybe why. And of course, the starting point for any creative testing is always to build a strong hypothesis. Why do we want to test, what we want to test, and how it should be tested. And with that, thank you for your attention. And I guess it's time for questions.
Thank you. Thank you, Lucia, for a very interesting presentation. There was actually one question around those specific examples, like, you know, when you had this, you know, Papi and those fitness creatives. So would you say that in this case, those that had best conversion rate and best ROI, they were like attracting the most relevant users compared to others, or like how you would say about that?
Yes, definitely. And this is also, so again, back to kind of everything getting sort of automated and user acquisition managers having less and less, levers to pull in terms of targeting. To target the right audience, this is where creative takes a place, and this is why also oftentimes you see, like, okay, when we have a great click through rate like 3 or 4%, in the end the conversion rate and the return on investment will not be that good, or it will not be the best out of the batch, and this is simply because it means that the creative didn't speak to that particular niche segment that you are trying to target. Mm-hmm. Which is also why, you know, like a lot more people clicked. So yes, the click through rate looks great, but actually the people who clicked were not that well targeted by that creative, so to say. So they don't end up converting as well once they are actually inside the app. So this is why the paradox, as I like to call it, works that way, right? So you actually, it's also in a way a good signal when the click rate is somewhat a little bit worse, because it means, okay, we are speaking only to those people that we are actually wanting to speak, and once those click, they do end up converting and paying in the app.
Thank you.
Good question, thanks.
I think I would also want to like kind of ask something from the questions that we've been already posted. Don't forget to post your questions, by the way. So overall, how often would you recommend base your ideas, base ideas of the creatives on the user or player profile? So would you use like player motivation for this one or not? Do you analyze like players' profiles before doing creatives, or is it completely different?
Yeah, absolutely. So I would do both, but I think for both, also for games and apps, it's definitely important to kind of nail down your target personas. Normally, you will have more than one, right? So with players, you normally have like the rookies and the hardcore players and so on. And so each one of these segments, a different set of elements or a particular thing might speak to more than the other. So for sure, this is something I would refer to when thinking about concepts, but also go crazy and think out of the box. But generally, yes, I think it's important to have a player or user personas and try to play to their motivation.
Okay, I think we can move to like our discussion. Like, you know, hello, Marijana and Snezana again. So Actually, the first questions around TikTok. You were talking about TikTok. It's probably a little bit question more related to user acquisition, but do you see it as the kind of marketing platform that is valuable for small indie companies, or you would start from Facebook, Google Ads? How you would see it from your experience?
Regarding UA for indie companies, so I will first start for the bigger one, so for with Google Ads and Facebook, and then move on and try different platforms to see what will work best for you, because you'll never know until you try it.
Sure. And Lucia, do you have anything to add from your side in this case?
No, I think it's, Marijana said it very correctly, you will never know until you try. And this goes also back to my point about teams creating, limitations and setting them up on themselves. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you really just do have to go a little bit crazy and maybe not super, brand consistent. And this applies specifically to the smaller companies. Of course, if you are Coca-Cola, it's kind of like you don't need to worry about that kind of thing. But if you're a small publisher, a new game or an app, oftentimes what we've seen is also that it's not the polished top-notch designs that work, but kind of the almost crappy looking homey videos made. And this is also something we've A/B tested a lot, high-end production done in studios compared to kind of like shooting just done with a phone in the hand, essentially. So definitely it's all about testing.
Yeah, I'd also add TikTok is a very specific platform. So it's new, fairly new, and two, it's just very, very specific. And the audience is just very specific. So for example, the usual recommendation for TikTok when it comes to creatives is, have people show your product or, play with your product. We tried it. It didn't work for us. So sometimes the recommendations just don't work because of the nature of your product. So yeah, definitely give it a try. But I agree with Marijana. If you're just starting out, go safe first and then see what you can and cannot do. And then you can experiment as much as you like.
Yeah, exactly. 100% agree. So this goes back to also benchmarks or things like, when people are saying you should do only video because video is what works. You should just try everything and see what works for you, because it may very well be different to what works for the rest.
That's cool. Thank you. Really, really love the answers. So I got actually a question today to myself, and it was from one of the studios I work with, and it was a question about misleading creatives. So I don't know, it's kind of very interesting topic, so everybody has opinion on it. So what's your experience? Really love this one.
We haven't done any. We just don't feel like we should deceive our users. I think it's a good marketing technique, depending on what your goal is. So for now, we don't need volume in that way. And that's why we decided not to test it at all. But depending on the goal, of course, I don't think it's immoral. It's just, what are you trying to get with that? And if this is okay with you, then yeah, go for it.
Yeah, totally agree. It's definitely down to the what is your goal. I myself also haven't done any purely fake creatives. Of course, every now and then you maybe play a little bit with the UI, you simplify it for the ad, so it's not like 100% true to the actual in-app experience. But personally, I've never found value in trying to, do something that is completely unrelated and fake, so to say, because that may again bring you great click-through rate and bring lots of users. But as soon as they land in the product, in the app, and realize that it's not what they expected at all, they'll be gone. Where is the value in that?
Yeah, thank you for your opinions.
And then maybe like from your experience, you know, how much time usually such creative experiment take? Like, you know, how much you were talking about, you know, 200-300 installs, but you know, do you have like specific, you know, time frame that you are trying to keep making not too short, not too long? Could you say a little bit about that?
Yeah, so personally, again, I would like aim to run for a full week to get, you know, just like the whole like weekly seasonality, so to say. But in most of the cases, like you can already tell after the first 2 to 3 days, you will see like, is this going to, you know, is it a loser or a winner? Sometimes you are on the fence, in which case it's best to really just run for the full 7 days. But yeah, sometimes it's just so bad or so good that you can tell. And it's also dependent on, of course, kind of how you're pacing your budget. And when you can reach the statistical significance, right? So again, if you're running for app installs, like you said, 200 to 300 normally brings that kind of 90% significance or more, which is ideally what you're looking for. But again, it depends also how you're optimizing and how much budget you are willing and wanting to spend on a daily basis.
If I can add here, in my experience, I would say that if you're not limited the algorithm with bidding strategy, you will have the faster results for Facebook platform. So when we are testing creatives on Facebook, we go for lowest cost bidding strategy. So in that way, we get faster results. If you are limiting it with bid cap or cost cap, I don't know, you're prolonging that learning phase, mm-hmm. and you will have the result, but maybe it will take more days than with not limiting it. And of course, it depends on country. If you are testing on in Asia countries, they are more expensive comparing to, I don't know, for example, India, which is more cheaper and for which, I don't know, for $50, you can have a lot of installs. And for, I don't know, 1 to 2 days, you will have enough results to decide on what works better for you.
Exactly. Yeah, I can confirm definitely no cap is the way.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we can move to the next one then to talk about the music, right? Music for creators. We saw a lot of really nice music creators today. And I think it's the first question, the first I would address it to you, Snezana, because you've been demonstrating like a lot of videos with different music performance. So have you tested the same videos with and without music? What was the result? Would you please share it with us?
Yeah, given that the specific videos that I showed were just for TikTok or primarily for TikTok, we didn't test them without the sound because we were advised that TikTok just doesn't work that way. So if you take out the sound, it doesn't work. So the recommendation was no, keep it. What we could do and what we've been planning to do is just to do the same creative but with different music, to see whether that has any impact. But unlike other platforms where you know, users can mute, usually TikTok users just don't mute when they scroll through. So the sound stays on. So you know, the short answer is no, but we also try not to rely too much on the music when we do our creatives, because we are aware of the fact that the phones might be muted and then you get not much out of it.
Lucia, do you have anything to add to this part?
No, not really. I think again, I agree with Snezana. Like for Facebook, it is normally oftentimes on mute, right, by default. Where I would just like to add that it's actually quite useful to add subtitles or at least like some quick short headlines to your videos, so that even though if people don't listen, they will just get the message straight away by looking mm-hmm. at the video. So that's something I like to do. And yeah, that's it. I think, again, also for TikTok, it is most cases the sound will be on, in which case I actually haven't done a lot of testing around just simply changing the music and keeping the exact same concept variation. This could of course very well have impact, but I don't have any data to talk about that.
And in some way, actually, you know, follow up on those questions that was a little bit touched before, like, you know, do you have maybe any advices around how to get the insights around the audience, you know, how to, like, you know, exactly like profile that audience, how to actually, you know, understand, like, you know, have some info about that audience before we start testing? What kind of, you know, like, you know, the ways you are using to get some info about that audience?
Yeah, so I mean, first of all, you will have some assumptions, right, that you will make. Mm-hmm. Like, let's say we made this game and we think it's for this and this type of players, and they like it because blah blah blah. And then ideally you would actually go and do focus groups, you know, and find people that really like the game and just talk to them, find out, okay, who they are, why do they like it, what do they do, maybe what's their lifestyle, and then you just kind of continue to develop from there on. Then of course there are also some market intelligence tools. Once you have a huge amount of users that can help you profile the people more in terms of demographics, or you can even run surveys inside your app yourself, which I've seen a lot of language apps actually do quite extensively in their onboarding session, which I found very interesting because I thought it was a bit exhaustive to like ask me 10 personal questions before I start using the app, but seems to be something that works in that vertical. So there are several ways to go around it. And I think, yeah, focus groups would be a good start for somebody who's just like getting started.
Yeah, also we, because we do user personas for our apps and games when we develop them, that's our starting point if we've not done any UA or the game is new. So we rely on what we've done with the research beforehand. Once the game is out and live, we rely a lot on user feedback as well. So the reviews that you get on Google Play or iOS, you can't really know what they do and how old they are. But based on your user replies, you can at least tell, you know, what they like. If you know what they like about the app, this is what you can emphasize in your creatives or your marketing copies. So you learn as you go along from your users. And then, of course, as Lucia said, once you get the data, the more data you have, the easier it gets. But I think initially, your user persona, if you have it, your user reviews are a good way to go. Of course, if you do queries and stuff inside the app, then of course that one serves well. But this is where you can start.
Yep.
Thank you.
Sure.
It's an interesting one. And I think this is the one we kind of touched before a little bit, but I would love to dive into it for some time. So is it worth actually spending more time on the creative graphic? Is it worth like polishing the ad, videos, process and everything? Or is it the best for testing just to, I don't know, make something and take a risk? So what's your recommendations here?
Just let it go. Of course, you don't want your creative to be horrible. You definitely need to pay attention to the design and, you know, make it look nice. But from our experience, it's just every time we said, okay, this is good enough, let's just get it going, it worked perfect. It worked very well. And then we'd be like, I think Lucia mentioned this in her presentation, you know, the designers would just love, it's their baby, this new video or this new banner, just because, you know, it looks beautiful, it's fantastic, and it does nothing, or it performs very poorly. So I would say, of course, have the balance of making it look nice. But if you're, you know, if you catch yourself just, you know, fixing that little dot here and there, let it go. It's good to go. Give it a try, and then you'll see if it works. You can play around with it.
100% agree with Snezana. Just do it. Launch it. See what happens.
Love it. Thank you.
And then there's the question around the sometimes there is like the reasons for long learning phase for some creatives. Like, do you have any maybe advice how to avoid it, how to work with that?
I think that I already answered that question. It's about the budget and the bidding strategy. So when you are testing the new concept, try to not to limit the algorithm. So try to use lowest cost bidding strategy along with the, I don't know, appropriate budget, and the learning phase will be finished. Every limitations prolong that learning phase.
Thank you.
And also, if you're doing Google Ads, I would just go back to what Marijana was talking about, the sort of finding the little hole in the system where, you know, if you see an ad group that just works really well when it comes to videos and banners, just insert your new banners and videos into that group. It may not be the same topic or theme, but if you see that the creatives of that sort perform well, just test it in that group, because Google Ads algorithm works that way. You know, it chooses whatever it finds best. So that might be one way to sort of shorten the learning phase as well.
Thank you.
Yeah, so the next one, the question is to Snezana and Marijana, but I think we will be also happy to hear your opinion, Lucia. Do you apply the winners from TikTok to Facebook and Google Ads since that where you test the most? So I think the question, if something really works good on TikTok or on Facebook or somewhere else, so would you kind of like translate those results into other networks and give it a try?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. You recycle. Recycle as much as you can. Sometimes it won't work, but definitely give it a try, because you won't know unless you give it a try. For example, if it's a video, then it's easier to adjust the sizes and the formats. If it's a banner, you may want to start with the one that you usually see performs the best in your different channels, and then, you know, go with that size. For example, you don't have to make 20 different ones, but definitely recycle.
Agree on recycling. I just normally do it the other way around. So for me personally, because just TikTok is not such a huge channel yet, I tend to test mostly on Facebook, right? And then take the winners from there and reapply them to TikTok and Snapchat. In terms of Google Ads, in my experience, actually, there it tends to be different concepts compared to like Facebook and the other social channels that work. But I would just still kind of test, you know, what works on one, on the others. Sometimes it sticks, sometimes it doesn't.
And if we go further, like, you know, we touch these user profiles and, you know, this data. What is your view on this iOS update? Yeah, what do you think is changing? What do you see coming with that, actually?
Okay, I don't think we can share much there, because we mostly test Android. iOS for creatives and campaigns is not big for us. What I can tell is pretty much what most people do know, and, you know, it'll be a change. It's definitely something that we need to follow and see how it goes, and then adapt to it. But given that we don't really have that much data, we may not be the best people to talk to about that.
Yeah, similar answer here. I mean, the changes are definitely big that are coming, right? Like, we will lose majority of the granularity of the data. Also, the testing will look differently, right? Like, there is a limited amount of campaigns and overall information that you can gather. So also the testing itself will be on one hand, a little bit more complicated, on the other hand, simplified, because if you want to make sure, so let's say that you are just not going to implement the ATT prompt at all, and basically all your users will be IDFA-less, and you will just rely on the SCAD network purely. In that case, probably the way I imagine this going forward is you will need to test the concept. You know, the concept will basically have its own campaign, and that's how you will be able to determine whether it works well in terms of bottom funnel performance for the creative in question.
Thank you.
May I add another question here? It's regarding iOS 14 as well. So did you start testing more in advance, kind of like piling up the good performing creatives just to let them go when iOS 14 is here?
We haven't done that yet. No.
I also haven't really piled up. I mean, it's a great idea, but you should always really be like piling up and producing as much as you can, and you know, just kind of scaling, of course, when there is budget and room. But this is definitely a solid idea.
Thank you.
And then you like maybe like you know, around this, you know, are there any insights how to beat the control video on Facebook, or like you know how to like the pattern in winning ads to rely on? So how what's your approach to this having this control video on Facebook?
Yeah, so with this is exactly as I was talking about. Yes, Facebook can be really tricky with the algorithm, and it starts skewing the delivery and results because it's kind of learned what is working for you right now. And that's where it comes super handy to either have a completely separate ad account where you're just testing new things, or at least you use a clean campaign where you test the new concepts, so that basically the, let's say, scaling campaign, your growth campaign, where you are using the winners, is separate from the one where you are testing the new creatives, and this will already help somewhat to minimize the pollution, so to say.
Yes, I would add also that there is no magic formula to beat a control video. You just need to produce new concept and to iterate and test, I guess, until you die. Just try to test more and more, and someday I guess you will beat a control one.
Exactly.
And winner.
It can be a lengthy process, definitely, like oftentimes super frustrating, but it is a numbers game. It is like my answer is really just have to keep trying, and eventually you will hit one.
Thank you.
Yeah, we talk about recycling a lot, by the way. Did you ever face this situation like, I don't know, this year, for example, you tested creatives. Those didn't work or performed poorly compared to the others. Is it like never try again, or is it maybe the audience is not ready for this concept yet and next year I will give it another try?
I think we recycled like that. So we'd go back and forth. Manya, you can correct me if that's not true, but yeah. I think we've reused. We let it, sleep for a little bit and then come back. So I would advise that. I don't think, I think even Lucia mentioned in her presentation, if it doesn't work now, maybe just your audience is not ready for it. It doesn't mean it's bad.
Yeah, and you can even retest the first concept. Okay, you proved the winner, but I don't know, after a month or you can again test those new concept and see what the results would be.
Exactly. Yeah, I tend to do that too. So whenever something doesn't work, so again, once for once you try to iterate on it, right? So you try like 2-3 different versions of it, and then you kind of just reassure yourself like, okay, it's really not the right time for this audience or whatever it may be. And I normally leave it maybe half a year, 3 months or so, and then try again. Truth be told, more often than not, they still don't work. But sometimes you find that suddenly they do it again. They didn't before. So especially if you're running out of ideas, I would definitely try and recycle and retest, maybe even on different audiences. You never know.
Also, sometimes you yourself can see different things when you look at the videos that you've tested. Mm-hmm. So you may get an, or the designers may get an idea that actually might work, you know, because as you look at it with fresh eyes, or, you know, you've done tons of creatives in the meantime, you may be able to sort of iterate in a little bit different way that may give it the boost that it needed.
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you. And maybe, like, you know, last question. We were talking about different like concepts, like testing different concepts. Like, you know, do you have anything to add in terms of, you know, how to test those different concepts? What is your kind of your approach to that?
Yeah, so as far as Facebook goes, I was mentioning that I would not rely on the built-in features for A/B testing or multivariate testing, because still the algorithm will go one way or the other and just push delivery on whatever it kind of prefers. So to make sure that you are really you know, just getting equal delivery and have comparable results, what I like to do is just put the creative or concept, sometimes it can even be like 2-3 variations, right, of the same concept in a single ad set, and then put the other creatives. So basically it's one ad set, one creative, essentially one concept, one ad set, with the same budget, same pacing, and then you kind of, so you like manually set up the A/B test, right, or multivariate test, and force equal delivery to each of the variants during the same time period, so that you can actually compare the results.
Nothing to add here. I completely agree.
Yeah, you just want to try it. You want to give your concepts the same audience. You want to give them the same conditions, so yeah, that you really, really test the concept as much as possible.
Exactly.
Okay. Thank you very much. I think if you would like to, you know, answer this last question around that, those, you know, these videos, I'm not sure if we understand what was the content of the question.
Okay, maybe. So with videos, it works the same as with banners. If you want to test concepts, you just test different concepts. If you want to test iterations, you just do iterations, because otherwise it's sort of not a fair test. You don't know, you know, why one took over and the other. So concepts, when you say different concepts, you know, you can't test a completely different idea. There's always going to be a little bit of something that the videos share, but you know, like Marijana said, and then also Lucia showed, different colors, like very different, I don't know, blue, and then you go red, and then you go pink or purple or whatever. So, but yeah, I wouldn't say mix concepts and iterations. It may not be a good idea.
Agreed.
If that's what the question was intended to ask.
Okay. Thank you very much for like sharing all that amazing knowledge with the audience. Thank you for your time. For everyone who is listening, please, of course, like visit the website for like to check out the other sessions. And then please, like once you would like to have the info about the future sessions, you know, please sign up for the newsletter. And then at the YouTube, we actually ask you about the sharing with us the feedback. Please do, so we can actually, you know, make it even better. And with that, I really would like, you know, to say thanks to Marijana, Julia, Lucia, and Snezana for like sharing that knowledge. And thank you very much for that again.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Thank you.
Thank you.